Good morning, good afternoon. I'd like to welcome everyone to this week's edition of Imperial as One's Belonging series, where we explore the experiences of individuals from the Black, Asian and ethnic minority communities. And this week, I'm really happy that we've got Nousheen Tariq with us. And Nousheen is a postgraduate educational manager here at Imperial College, but she's so much more than that. And Nousheen, I just want to give you a big welcome today as we investigate and share your story. So Nousheen, can you kick off by letting us know a little bit about your early childhood and where you gained your sense of identity, your sense of belonging as you were growing up, please?
Yes, absolutely. I'm so nervous. This is worse than a job interview. So my parents emigrated from Pakistan. Mm-hmm. My dad came in, I think, mid-60s, and then he got married, and my mum came in 1968. So they had no knowledge of the UK. It was very alien to them. And so we were brought up in a household, you know, as first generation British, sort of born and bred. But the situation they were in, they were very young. Mid-20s, my mum I think was still a teenager when she got married, and they had to adapt their behaviours and beliefs to fit into society in like a different country, different language, all of those things, and at the same time they were fiercely protective of their identity as Pakistanis and what they cherished in all of that, and their main aim was to be financially secure, to give their children a better life, as we all want to, and provide for everything that the family needs. My dad was the main sort of, it was his income, my mum didn't work. It was really important for them to bring up good, obedient kids. I think this is the nature of the Pakistani culture when it comes to families, that, you have to be, you have to do as your parents say, you have to be obedient, but also, because they came into a country that was foreign to them, they conformed to everything. And I think that sort of rubbed off on us. It certainly rubbed off on me as an individual. So, I think we can all see the sort of people pleasing side of ourselves in our personalities to some extent. Yeah. But I think I have quite a lot of that. Grew up 70s, 80s in always been in quite a heavily South Asian populated area.
That was familiar
to them, that was comfortable to them, that's what they knew, and they wanted to be surrounded by sort of people like them. Mm. But it was always like my father especially, I think he didn't want to exert sort of his sort of South Asian or Pakistani side of things too much when he was mixing with people from different backgrounds, because he didn't want that to be in their face. So, one example is if you were around people that didn't understand your language, then it was really rude to speak in your own language at all. And, we were told not to do that.
Right.
That was sort of a little bit of background of my upbringing. And, we went to the local secondary school that was just the school we were assigned to. They were very happy getting an education in the UK compared to their own upbringing, and it didn't really matter what the school was like, it was the worst one in the area as it happens, but that for them was success, that we were in the UK, the children being educated in the UK.
So your dad was the main breadwinner, he brought you up, or both your mum and dad brought you up to be not in your face, don't put your culture in other people's faces, etc. Am I right to say that? It was kind of like let's fit in. We are here. Was it their intention to stay here, or were they thinking of going back? Did you ever gauge that?
That's another thread that was actually throughout our lives, is that we kept hearing that they're going to go back. I think it's really difficult to accept that you've sort of burnt those bridges.
Yeah.
And we did keep on hearing this, and they did actually try. So right. It was, there's three of us, so I've got an older brother and a younger sister. And when it was just my brother and I, they actually moved back,
right,
and they came back with no money at all. It didn't work out. I don't know don't want to go into that side of things, but they gave it a go. And I think maybe then when they came back and they're two, you know, young children and had to find somewhere to live and work and everything all over again, I think that's what they may have started to accept that, you know, this is home.
Yeah.
And but even be after that, when we were older, we would hear that, you know, they're aspiring to sort of go back. And what they have managed to do is buy a place there. They've now got a home there. They've got their own house. And I think that was a massive achievement. They've only been able to do that in retirement. But that was quite important for them to be able to do that.
So they excuse me, they've maintained their connection with Pakistan, and they're able to develop, they've got a place there, even though they've kind of like accepted, in reality, their children and a lot of their grandchildren, everything, are here in the UK.
Yeah, that's right. They've got all the other relatives and families back home in Pakistan, and their immediate family, children, grandchildren are here. And I think this definitely feels more like home to them.
Right. So the reason why I ask that is just kind of like when you're growing, as you were growing up, it's what kind of messaging you were getting to say, well, you're here to stay or we're on our way back. And it's going to affect the way that you kind of like perceive yourself in this society. But it sounds like from what you've said, you were very much encouraged to actually think about, this is home. This is our home. This is what we've experienced. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, my parents weren't strict in their upbringing. They, you know, compared to some South Asian parents, I had friends at school, their parents were so strict. You know, there'd be girls that would come dressed in one thing and then change into other things that they actually wanted to wear and then change back before they came home. But I think the main thing is, Wayne, they hadn't done this before. They don't know how to bring up children in a diverse community. And they were really scared that something would happen, or we, you know, in our upbringing, they would somehow fail their culture. And that, you know, I think that they would be letting their elders down or their family down by, you know, not doing the right thing or what's perceived to be the right thing in bringing up your children. So I think there was a lot of pressure probably that they put themselves under.
So I don't want a stereotype or anything, but was, as the eldest girl, you said you've got an older brother and then a younger sister. So as the eldest girl, were there more expectations on you within the family as the oldest girl, in kind of like the life choices that were open to you, if that makes sense?
Do you know what? Whatever family you look at, I think the younger children do get an easier ride slightly, because, you know, you're the first sort of child that your parents are going to try things with. And it's also down to personalities, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we would have trips, family trips back home to Pakistan, whether it was for a wedding or just to, you know, sort of keep in touch with their relatives. That was the other thing, that my parents, as working class people, they had to be able to afford the really expensive flights back home so that we would stay in touch with that side of our culture and our family. And I loved it there. I loved it. I really liked the lifestyle, you know, the fact that you get to meet your extended family. And then they had aspirations for me to marry someone there, because that for them was another way to sort of keep that going and to solidify that connection. And, you know, I love the idea of living there, and I married somebody from Pakistan, and I'm really glad that my children have, you know, that very strong connection with Pakistan, more so through my husband than me, because I don't know it that well. And I lived there for 5 years. When I was pregnant, I wanted to be I wanted the medical sort of advances that were here. So I didn't have my, you know, my son was born here rather than in Pakistan, but then I went back and he went to nursery there. But I think that they did, I think there was probably that thing, oh, she likes it there, we can make this happen, you know.
So
it was a sort of joint decision that I'm open to, you know, finding a partner from here or from Pakistan would be fine as well. But yeah, I think, you know, there's a big age difference between my sister and I. We're 7 years apart. And I, you know, you can say it's a big sister thing, or you could say it's a eldest daughter thing, but I think it's in all families where, being older does mean that there's sort of more focus on you for some things. I don't know if it's a South Asian thing.
No, I don't know. I think you're probably right in saying that as the elder, your parents are still trying things out.
Yeah.
They are still trying things out, and things may happen for the younger ones, which they've learnt their lessons through the oldest children's experiences. So I do totally understand that. Yeah. So in terms of, you mentioned about getting married, but before you got married and stuff, in terms of going through school, you also mentioned about the school that you went to wasn't that great. What was kind of like the aspirations from your parents for you going through school? What was their expectations? What did they want you to do? And what did you want to do at the same time?
Yeah, they always just wanted their children to do their best in whatever they choose to do. Mm-hmm. There was no pressure whatsoever. They didn't have any aspirations for what qualifications we should leave with or mm-hmm. anything like that. They would always turn up for parents' evening and be very proud and, you know, didn't really give it a critical, a view that was just like, great, great, great. We're loving all these nice things you're saying about our children. So there were no aspirations educationally that, you know, that it'd be quite good if you did this, or, you know, maybe you should aim for this. It was just, are you doing your best? We can see you're working hard. If you think you're going to be good at that thing, yeah, go and do it. That was it. And for myself, I think I was at a school where, if, you know, in those days, Wayne, teachers would just teach. They won't go, here's someone that needs more support, or here's someone that is exceeding in this area, so we need to push them a little bit more. Mm-hmm. You know, so I was quite good at maths, and I think if I had been, you know, pushed in that side, you know, developed more, then that would have benefited me later. Yeah. And, you know, maybe I would have gone to university, because I didn't go to university. I just left after O-levels. But yeah, my own aspirations were, I don't know, I was young. I didn't care. I was just having a good time, seeing my friends every day at school, and I had friends that were aspiring to go to university, but mine was just like, oh, what shall I do now? Some O-levels, took myself along to the career service office. Wasn't part of school, but it was like a local initiative. And I saw a careers advisor there, and I said, oh, I've got these O-levels, like, I don't know what to do next. And she was like, oh, there's a secretarial course at the local college. Why don't you go and do that?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there wasn't any other choice I could have asked for other options. There were, you know, I was just like, okay, you know, I don't know. I just like, just went with it. It's just how I was then. Really naive, I think.
Yeah. So the reason, there's a couple of things which from what you've said, there's one about, do you think it was more important that your parents, from your parents' perspective, that you as children grew up with manners and respect as opposed to necessarily going for educational achievement? They wanted you to represent the family in a certain way which wasn't going to bring disrespect or anything like that to the family. Do you think that may have been slightly more?
Yeah, slightly more, but they knew, they wanted us to be well-rounded people.
Yeah.
But I don't know that they necessarily understood how to do that in the best way, because can see from my children how they've benefited from moving out and going to university and, you know, having that independence and meeting different groups of people and learning from the things that are happening in their different sort of social circles. And I, you know, in the South Asian community, it's perceived to be bad to be out all the time, or, mm-hmm. you know, to be, yeah, not wanting to be at home, to not want to spend all your time at home. And I think that they were doing their best, but they wanted us to be well-rounded individuals and be confident in life, but at the same time, they were holding on to the values they knew, which is, you know, especially for girls, you don't go around, you know, going out every night, staying out late.
Yeah.
And that's just the way it is. You know, that's that part of the culture they needed to hold on to.
Yeah, yeah. And there was another point which you mentioned, which was about when you went to the careers advice. And there's, I know, I totally understand what you're saying in terms of what kind of role models did you have in the community for you to say, well, could I aspire to that? Or if there weren't any role models, it doesn't sound as though the kind of careers advice, it wasn't really advice. It was kind of, you could go and do that, but there wasn't really a discussion. Is that right? Or am I off the mark?
Yeah, that's right. I don't remember any role models, because in those days, you know, the school didn't bring people in or profile people in any way saying, you know, if you're interested in this, look at what this person's been able to achieve. There was nothing like that. I don't remember anyone in my family either, because, you know, when we were growing up, it was my parents and us, three siblings. We did have family friends, and most of them I remember had much younger children, but I don't remember any role models, you know, at school or outside school. I mean, I guess, you know, teachers can be role models, but yeah, I don't know, there's no lasting impression or memory that I have of that sort of thing at all.
Okay.
So just made use of what was there, and that was the careers office.
So the careers office, did you what happened with this secretarial position then that you went for, because you took the advice of the careers officer?
Happened? But because, you know, you've got to conform, you've got to agree with everything that everyone else is saying and the opinions that everyone else has, and you know, you're not going to really question that. And so I was like, oh, this person must know what they're talking about. So I went to college, had a good time, a couple of years there, and then left. And then, you know, my career started as a secretary, and, you know, I'm really fortunate that I've had opportunities in my career, especially at Imperial, but being here quite a long time, to, you know, add to that and progress and, you know, do things, you know, sort of veer away from that and do other things that I enjoy more.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that, I guess, you know, that was a good stepping stone. And I, you know, we all have hang-ups, don't we? And I've said to you, Wayne, about how, you know, for many years, and not now, because I'm a lot older and I don't really care, but I had hang-ups about not having a degree. And when I was a secretary, I had a hang-up about being a secretary, because people, there are certain connotations with that. Yeah. And I was desperate to shrug it off at one point in my career. And I'm, you know, I'd go back to it now. It was great. It was such a stress-free job.
I totally understand. But the thing about it is, it's about how, what value people place in those different roles. And that's where I think part of the problem comes from, that you do need the secretarial support and everything like that. And it's a very valuable job. So how did you get from the, you said that you haven't got a degree, and we've discussed that. Well, we have had mentioned that previously. So how did you get from being a secretary to now being an education, postgraduate educational manager? And what was the transition, and what was that journey like? Because clearly to get from there, it's demonstrating that you had a trajectory.
Yeah. It was really validating, actually, because I think I met people that supported me, and I had managers and line managers and like department heads who, you know, if I had time in my working day, I'd say, oh, do you want me to do this? Or they'd say, you've got time, can you do this? And I think that, you know, through their support and proving that I was able to do more, I just got involved in more things. And then, you know, when opportunities presented themselves, I, you know, took on work outside my remit. And then at one point in the education office where I'm based, there was a need for to support a small team for postgraduate medicine. And my then line manager, Susan English, said, you know, I need someone to do this. And at the same time, my boss, who was Professor Jenny Hyam, she was moving to a more senior position and, moving to another building and needed a PA there. And I said, actually, this is the time for me to decide, do I want to carry on with that or do I want to do something new? And I didn't know what that something new was.
Right.
And I remember Susan at the time saying to me, don't worry, I, you know, you are very valuable to me. This is going to work. And I think it was just before the Christmas break. So I was like, I'm going on this like Christmas break, not knowing what I'm coming back to. But I said to Jenny, you know, I've loved our time together, but I need to do something different now in my life.
Yeah.
I think I was in my 40s, you know, by the time I made that sort of bold move. And that's how it happened. I was just presented with opportunities that, you know, I heard a student talk a while ago. I think it was Nessa Carey, who used to work at Imperial. And she said to this lecture theatre full of people at one of our PG Connection events that always say yes to any opportunity that presents itself, because you don't know what's going to come out of that.
Yeah.
And I think it's such a good piece of advice. And I remember clocking it at the time and I go, right, I'm gonna do this. And, you know, I don't think I would have agreed to this, Wayne, if it wasn't for that piece of advice. It's like, Mainly said to me, do you want to do this? And I was like, yes, you know. So even when you're a bit scared and you're not sure, you've got to take a bit of a leap of faith. I've done this Springboard Women's Development course at Imperial, and they asked me to come and do a talk.
Yeah.
To a subsequent cohort. And, you know, I think we all get nervous about these things. And I went, yes. It's just that advice in my head. It's like, always say yes, always say yes. So I think it was a bit of that, just, you know, going, okay, yeah.
So, but this, you're downplaying yourself, I think, because at that moment in time, you had two people who were actually wanting you to go with them. You had Sue English, who had obviously seen what you were able to do and recognized the abilities that you had. And you also had Jenny Higham, who was going off to another position, but you had to make that decision. So I'm going to just probe a little bit to ask a little bit more about that decision-making process for you, because it's something which I think sometimes we can be a bit reticent about making those kinds of decisions. So what were the things which you were trying to weigh up when you were making that choice? I know we haven't discussed this, but just when you said it, it's just...
What was I weighing up? I think I didn't see any growth in the... I felt like I'd done everything with it that I could, and I didn't see any opportunity. And I, you know, we're all different. But for me, I have to do something again and again and again to be good at it. And I have to be beyond confident in something that I'm doing to believe that I'm good at something that I'm doing. So in all my years at Imperial, it's that repetition and doing things, you know, for a while, that gives me the confidence. And I think that because I'd had the opportunity to do like projects and things outside the remit of my role, that helped me to say, yes, I'm going to leave that behind, something that's familiar to me, because I hate doing that. This is the reason I'm still at Imperial. I probably can't really picture myself anywhere else. I would never have let go of something that's familiar to me and I'm good at and jumped to something else unless I'd had that sort of little bit of tester, sort of being able to try it out, I think.
So it was that initial, just trying that, seizing those little opportunities which were presented, developing and honing your craft, and then feeling confident, I can do this job. And so that's when you accepted it and took it on board.
It's terrible because we're surrounded by people, really dynamic people, who can go, right, you know, in a very short space of time, they've got the measure of something, they know what they're going to do with it, and they can do it quickly, learn it, and then moving on to other jobs. I know a lot of things come into this. It's about, you know, preferences and personality and everything. But I'm always in awe of people that can do that. But I know that what makes me happy is learning to do something really well. And I think it's really important to understand yourself to be content in life. So I am in awe of other people, but I don't want to be like them. I can't be like them.
I like that. I do like that. That's their pathway. This is my pathway. I'm happy in where I am.
That's right.
So you've been at Imperial for a while. I'm not going to say how long. You've been here for a while, right? Now, I always have this saying is, you won't stay for long if you don't feel you belong. So do you feel that you belong? What is it that's helped you feel that you belong here at Imperial?
It was very daunting at first because you're surrounded by all these like amazing qualified people, professors, doctors, and you're like, here's a little me that just has my O-levels. But what made me feel I belong is the people. Is I did see people that were like me in some way, you know, like, maybe they've not been to university or they're South Asian. When I joined the education office, I think there was no one, or there was one other Asian, South Asian person.
Right.
And I've seen the workforce diversify in the, I will tell you how long I've been here, in the 18 years I've been at Imperial, okay. Which is really nice to see. But yeah, what made me feel like I belong is the people, is the friendships, is talking to people and understanding that they're going through similar experiences. That camaraderie, friendship is invaluable.
I'm going to just, one final question before I bring the audience in if they want to ask some questions as well. So if you've got some questions, get them ready. I know that you're also involved with the union as well. Is that right? What was it that got you into kind of like thinking about working with the union and what the union does?
It was, my parents are working class, but we never talked about unions. I'm sure my dad, because he was a factory worker at one point, would have been part of a union or heard of it, but I had no knowledge, no education at all on trade unions. But there was a much younger colleague in my team who was very passionate about you know, workers' rights and unions, and she educated me on it because the Imperial Trade Union, the UCU, were in dispute over devaluing pensions, which was still balloting at the moment, right now, as we speak about that, and said, we're going to go on strike. And I was like, oh, yeah, I fancy a bit of that. I've always heard. And it was just that a lot of colleagues, a lot of my friends in the education office were like, yeah, this is wrong. And so I was trying to understand what the problem was and learned so much from people that knew about this. And then when I was on the picket line, I learned a lot as well, because when you're part of a trade union, you hear about things from both sides. So you will hear from your employer and you will hear the sort of, you know, if you like, opposing view from the trade union. And so it was such a learning curve for me. But I joined because I understood the basics of the dispute and I agreed that the employer should not be so stubborn. And I thought we need our voices heard. Simple as that.
And I suppose within that union, then again, you've had that sense of belonging because you had a common cause, a common goal, aim, objective.
Absolutely. Yeah. People of all levels, from, you know, professors to administrators to cleaners to, you know, all different pay scales, all different departments across college were on the picket line together as one. It was, we did have a common goal and, It was such an education, honestly.
It's brilliant. I'm going to open up for questions. I've got a couple others which I would like to ask, but the time we're at the moment, I'm going to see if there's anyone else who's got a question that they'd like to ask Nousheen.
Do you want me to take them from the top? Should we wait for someone to come on camera? So if you got him in nice and early.
There was one here, which I saw. All right, we could ask this one. It was from Sophie, and it says, did your parents ever reflect back thinking maybe they should have let their culture out of the home more, or that it was really, or it really helped their family flourish in the UK? I'm not sure if I've read that very well.
I think I understand what you mean, Sophie, but I think that I think those were different times. I think that when it was the right environment, they did. So when they were around other South Asians, or even if somebody asked, you know, you don't tell unless you're asked about your South Asian heritage, then it was fine to talk about it. And my mum's always worn the traditional outfit, you know, the shalwar kameez. I think there are pictures of her in the 60s and 70s where she's wearing flares and tops and things. You know, she was a young woman. Yeah. So she was trying all of that out. But in terms of letting their culture out of the home more, they were who they were, but it was mainly around other South Asians and it within the home. They didn't want to really tell other people or educate them in any way about this. It was just they just stuck to what they knew and what was comfortable. They were not equipped. I think the question about did it help their family flourish in the UK, I think they just didn't know what to do, what would be the best thing to do, and they tried their best. They tried their best, yeah, to get a balance. They tried their best to get a balance of our children are growing up as British and we are Pakistani.
Yeah. Was there ever any times where there was conflict between the way that they perceived that you were growing up and the way that they wanted grow?
Yes. Oh my God. My mum, she'll forgive me for saying this. When I was growing up, she'd be like, girls in Pakistan don't do that. Girls in Pakistan won't talk to their mother like that. Girls in Pakistan will be doing this by then. And as I said, I lived there for 5 years. Oh my God, it could not be further from the truth. I worked as a teacher in a nursery and there were lots of young girls there, same age as me, you know, some sort of settled, some not. And everything goes on, you know, boyfriends, it's just all underground, drugs, alcohol, everything. So yeah, that, I came back and I went to a, by the way.
That's really good.
My mum was stuck in the Pakistan that she knew, and she was brought up in a very strict household. So
yeah, okay.
I don't blame her for not knowing.
Yeah. There's another question. It's more of a statement, but it leads to a kind of question, and it says that sounds a little bit like my own family from the Caribbean. I think that people pleasing, just fitting in, everything British is superior. It's a colonial legacy. Would you agree
with that, Kim?
Absolutely.
If you go back, it is a colonial mindset, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I think it is also more for girls, but definitely in the South Asian community, it's more like the fitting in or, you know, obedience and things like that. I think boys get it as well, but I think that there is a bit of leeway with them.
Right.
So there is that sort of gender imbalance, I think.
I suppose, because we've been talking a little bit about parenting, one of the questions that kind of like springs to mind is, you having grown up in this westernized society, as it were, and having your own children and everything like that, have you found yourself parenting similarly to your parents, or have you developed a different kind of style of parenting compared to what your parents did for you, if you can compare and contrast? I know it was different times and stuff like that, but are there occasions
where... You know what? I think it's a weird connection to make, but I think working at Imperial and obviously the friends that I've made here have really helped me, I think, be a better parent. So if you're open to other, you know, if you're open to absorbing other things that are happening in other families and with people that you know, and able to apply or to make sense of it in context of your own family and children, I think it can be really helpful. And I am quite a really relaxed, laid back parent, mother, because my husband does all the worrying. So I'm able to be really relaxed and go, well, we can't have double the worrying. And I rely on him to ground my children on the Pakistani cultural side of things.
Right.
And also religion, you know, because I am Muslim. I'm not fully practicing, you know, I fast, but I don't pray 5 times a day. And I think that he brings that sort of knowledge. So together, we are bringing them up in a very different way. And we're allowing them, because I had the experience of growing up in Britain, allowing them to become more absorbed in society as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
But keeping them fully informed of their heritage. It's really hard to compare with how I was brought up. It is really difficult, but my parents weren't strict. My mom had certain views on things to do with her culture, but they were also laid back, but I think I've sort of taken it a step further.
Right. No, that's fine. I understand that. I do understand that. And I do like the way that you said your husband's the worrier. That's a good thing to, you know, let him do the worrying. You just
yeah.
I wonder to myself, because now your children are at an age where they're going to be making decisions and stuff like that. What advice would you have given, like, what kind of advice did you give your children, which you may wish you had had when you were kind of like their age?
I think just to grasp every opportunity. I think just having information. Mm-hmm. So, you know, throwing them out there and going, go on, move out and go to university. Mm-hmm. Always wanted both my children to move out.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want them to have the comfort of home and, like, not go outside their, you know, what they know, what they like, what they're comfortable with. I was like, they knew from an early age. I wanted them moved out for university so that they could have that experience.
Yeah.
And whatever happens at university, they are going to grow as people. Mm-hmm. So I would just say, you know, experience as much as you can, and, you know, get as much information as you can. That's about yourself as well, more than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you understand yourself as individuals, then you can make more of a success of your life.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, when you settle down with people, how are you meant to have a good relationship with anyone if you don't understand yourself? And I think I've suffered from that a little bit because, you know, we were so protected growing up.
Mm-hmm.
That in a way, even when I was married, mm-hmm. Yes, I was young, I got married at 25, but I was still trying to understand myself. I guess we always are in life, but I think that it's best to get that over and done with early in life, you know.
Yeah.
Understand people, understand yourself. So, and that comes from experiencing different things.
Yeah.
And I think that would have been my advice, is just, you know,
so
this is going to help in life.
Yeah. So it's to take them out of a comfort silo, as it were. Take them out of that comfort zone, get them to experience different things so that they're not afraid to try different things, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's right.
And they can
learn from that.
That's right. So each experience that they have, you don't want it to be a detrimental experience, but they have to experience something or put themselves into a position where they can see something different.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think there's this belief that some people have that you can learn from other people's mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you can give advice based on your own sort of experiences, but I really don't think you do learn that much. You're not going to remember someone else's mistakes, but you're never going to forget a mistake you've made.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think that's what we need to do.
Yeah. Thinking about that, what you've just said, that's very true. Someone can warn you and warn you and warn you, but you still, until you've experienced it for yourself, sometimes you still won't learn the real lesson. You can have an idea of what the lesson should be, but you don't learn the lesson until you've actually experienced it. I'm not advocating for anybody out there to go and do anything which you can learn real lessons from. That's not what I'm saying. But sometimes there are certain things which you have to allow your children or yourself to experience, because then they'll learn, and then it may be that they'll save themselves a heartache and pain of something much more severe, because they were just so naive or just hadn't had those early experiences.
That's it. You've hit the nail on the head there. That's exactly it.
Yeah.
And that's what I passionately wanted for my, and the other thing I passionately want is never to get my kids to live in an extended family. I haven't had any awful experiences, but before I know who they're settling down with, I've said to my son, because traditionally sons stay with their parents, you know, get the wife to come into the same home. And my husband and I have differing views on this, but he knows where I stand and I don't think he's going to get in my way. And I said to my son, I don't know who your future partner's going to be. Whoever they are, I don't want them under this roof. So that's my next thing. I'm like, the kids knew I wanted them to move out and go to university. The next thing is, like, you are not living here. I treasure my relationship with you too much.
it's true. The cuckoos, or not the cuckoo, but the birds, once they push the fledglings out of the nest, they don't come back and live in the house. They go find their own nest. So The nest could be nearby, but it's their own little nest.
That's it. You're not a yo-yo. That's it.
Nousheen, it's been absolutely brilliant having this conversation. And you've answered the question which I normally ask, which is what advice would you give? Just fun. What would you like to see? You've been at Imperial for 18 years. What would you like to see Imperial do going forward in terms of diversity, etc.?
You've put me on the spot there, and all I can think of is that I really want them to just stop. Look, we can see there are improvements that are happening, but I really want all of the talking and sort of drowning in words to stop. There's a lot, I can't think of the term at the moment, but you know, lip service and, you know, policies that say a lot but don't actually say a lot. I'd quite like that to stop. Sometimes I read these new policies and things that come out and I think, I don't understand what's being said. It's like all the words sound nice. Mm-hmm. Which means it must be a good thing that's happening here. So I don't always believe that. And I would like Imperial to, you know, just simplify, cut the just drowning in words. It's so much information sometimes. I get suspicious. I think, is there anything of real value or substance actually happening? So yeah, maybe just... You know, I think as part of all of the work that was accelerated through Black Lives Matter, I think that there are obviously reports and outputs that are being published, and I think those will speak for themselves. If we continue to diversify staff and students, I think that's amazing. Not just students. If we can see staff can see people like themselves at Imperial, I think that has to be a good thing. You know, I think often staff are speaking, you know, for students, and you can't do that if you don't understand where those students are coming from. So yeah, well done for, you know, to Imperial for all the efforts they've put in and what we've achieved, but we need to keep going and not let up, I think.
I like the sentiment of that. It's kind of like more action, less talk. Let's get on with the job. That we know that there's a job to be done. Let's not have too many fancy words. Let's just get it done. So Nousheen, it's been great. I'm going to just read out one final comment from a colleague who says they've known you for a number of years. Nousheen, who I've known for many years at Imperial and very proud of her and where she is today. She's always been super helpful and always obliging with me also.
Bless you, Dawn.
She's a lovely, lovely woman and leaves a lasting impression on people. Thank you so much. Right. And I have to agree with that because I've known you for a few years and your radiant smile whenever I come into the room. I don't know if it's just me that you're just, but I think you smile at everyone.
Just you. Right. Thank you, Wayne. Thank you. And thanks, Dawn, for those lovely words. Right. Yeah, it's been a pleasure. Honestly, I was so nervous.
You've been brilliant. You've been brilliant.
And I'd encourage everyone to say yes to if you're approached about the belonging interviews.
Thank you for that. I'm looking at all the names now. But Nousheen, it's been really good. And thank you for sharing your experiences and your story with us this afternoon. I'm going to just jump across and let people know what's happening next week. And next week we're going to... Next week we're going to have Rafael Dos Santos, who's a multi-award-winning entrepreneur, TED Talk speaker, and he's a spokesman for migrant entrepreneurs. So I think it's going to be quite interesting to have a listen to what he's Brazilian. So we're going to have a nice little conversation with him next week. And if you have missed any of the Belonging series so far, then please go to our YouTube channel, which is tinyurl.com/belonging-IAO. And please have a look through some of the other interviews. They are quite good. So have a good weekend, and I hope to see you again very shortly, well, next week. So thanks very much for joining us today. Bye-bye.